Before the convention assembled, they gathered at Mount Vernon to plan a bold undertaking.
General Washington, another such outbreak as this Massachusetts affair, and we shall have anarchy. I foresee trouble in other places also.
Yes, Colonel Hamilton. There are combustibles in every state that a spark might set fire to. But who besides a Tory or a Briton would have predicted this?
Quite true, General. Madison and I have been talking over a plan of action. We feel that no halfway measures will do.
No, General. No use to talk of amending the Articles of Confederation.
What is your plan?
About this meeting at Annapolis, General. With your influence and the support of others, we might use this meeting to make a general appeal for action toward a new framework of government.
We must not let this opportunity slip away, General.
Under Washington's leadership, the plan succeeded. Delegates from five states met at Annapolis to send out a call for a convention to revise the Articles of Confederation. In May 1787, the old State House in Philadelphia saw the gathering of delegates for this convention. It was a meeting almost unique in history. Seldom before had men assembled for the expressed purpose of drafting a written constitution for a nation. But these men held, in common with other Americans, that the powers of government should be bound by written law.
The plan was called a Constitution of the United States and was a masterpiece of compromise, which created something larger than anybody expected. The United States was to be a republic with elected representatives. The plan was original, worked out to fit the peculiar circumstances. Government was to be by laws, not by officials. It was divided into three sections. The legislative branch to make the laws. An executive branch to carry on the business of government. And a judicial branch to decide questions of law under the Constitution. The legislative branch was itself divided into two parts. A house to represent the people. And the Senate representing the states. The legislative power was balanced between the large and the small states. The executive power of the government was placed in one man, the President of the United States. He would be responsible to the people for all departments of government. As a check against the possibility of abusing his executive powers, it was provided that his veto could be overridden by a two-thirds vote of both houses. To further protect the rights of the people under the Constitution, a judicial body, the Supreme Court, was created. This body, operating independently of the legislative and executive branches, could be called upon to interpret the constitutionality of any law. Thus, the three branches of the government are constantly balancing and checking the power of each other. This was the gist of the work done at the Philadelphia Convention. After what I had gone through, the plan sounded good to me, and to others too. But Gerald Wellman, who had been a soldier in the War of Independence, said that it didn't even mention the rights of man. And Goodman Barlow said that the Constitution ought to guarantee the states the right to run their own internal affairs. These sounded like good ideas to me,